Hey, good morning, ACC. We're going to do things a little out of order this morning. Is that all right? So typically right now, if you've been here for a while, you know that we kind of transition into a time of offering. And we're gonna move that to the end of our service today. We're going to dive into something that I think is really important for us to spend some time talking about. Real fast, by way of introduction, my name is Matt. I have the privilege of serving here as one of the pastors on staff, and it's just a privilege that I love what I do. I hope that you can see that on Sunday mornings out of our staff, that you can tell that we really enjoy what it is that we do. But I'm just really glad each of you are here. Real fast, a quick announcement. On the first Sunday of every month, so that would be March 4th would be the next one, we have a class that we do called Starting Point. And I wanted to extend an invitation to you if you have never been to our Starting Point lunch. I called it a class. It is a class, but let's get rid of that word because nobody likes going to a class. Let's call it a lunch, all right? So what we're going to do, we're going to provide you a free lunch. Usually it's either Qdoba or Mission Barbecue. We feed you really well. And this lunch is for anyone who has never been to the lunch before. So if you're in this room and you're thinking, I've been to ACC for 10 years, have you been to this lunch before? If not, this lunch is for you. It's the first step of our membership process. It's also a great place. If you've been coming to ACC just for a couple weeks, maybe this is your first week here. By the way, I'm really glad you're here if that's the case. This lunch is a great place for you to find out who we are, what we're excited about, what makes Arundel Christian Church unique. So we want to invite you to that. That's not this Sunday. It's not next Sunday. The Sunday after that, March 4th. And you can find out more about that at arundelcc.org/startingpoint. So let's dive right in. We are doing a one-off. So this is not the start of a new series called Generous. We're just talking about generosity today. And then we're going to start a brand new series next Sunday called Psalm 23. And we're going to walk through Psalm 23 together. I'm really excited about it. But let me tell you what. Anytime a church talks about generosity, it gets really uncomfortable for certain people in the room. All of a sudden, the pastor's talking about money again, right? The pastor's after my wallet, right? Listen, if it makes you uncomfortable that we're talking about generosity, this message is probably for you. Let me put it this way. My wife and I, we decided to homeschool our girls. And as a homeschooler in Maryland, you have to do this thing called a homeschool review. So twice a year, you have to put a report together and you have to show it to the state so that the state can approve your homeschool work. And usually, the idea of putting a report together and having someone else look over your shoulder at what you're doing, that would be super uncomfortable. But you know what? My wife loves going to those things because she knows she's been doing a great job. And she knows that when the state looks over and looks at the report of what we've been doing with our girls, that they're going to say, you are a homeschooling parent. You're doing a great job at this. The same way when we are followers of Christ. Now listen, I recognize there are people in this room right now that you're saying, hey, that's not me. I have not committed my life to following Christ. That's okay. Listen, turn me off for just a second. I'm really glad you're here. For those of you in this room who have chosen to follow Christ, if someone were to look into your life, would what they see reflect the generosity that comes with being a follower of Christ? And if not, you're probably not going to like the pastor talking about generosity. If you are a generous person, right now you're thinking, this is going to be awesome. I can't wait to hear Matt talk about this. So maybe that's a fair kind of gauge right now about whether or not you are a generous person. We're not just talking about money. We're talking about time. Are you generous with your time? Are you generous with your talents? Do you share the gifts and skills that you have with other people? Are you a generous person? Let's talk about that. Let's pray first. Father, I am so thankful that you are a generous God. God, when we come here on a Sunday morning, we know that we're worshiping a God who gave everything for us. And we ask right now that you would teach us from your word and from experience and the way you're working in our lives to see how you call us to be generous people too. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I did a word study to kind of see how many times different words were used in the Bible. And this is interesting to me. The word believe, right? The word believe seems like something that would appear in the Bible often. It does. 272 times does the word believe appear in the Bible. The word pray, that sounds like it would be in the Bible even more, you know, like an action verb. Let's say, how many times does the Bible tell us to pray or to use the word pray? 371 times, 100 times more than believe. How about the word love? The Bible must be full of the word love, right? You would be right. 714 times is the word love used in the Bible. How about the word give? We're talking about generosity. Love is mentioned 714 times. The word give is used in Scripture 2,152 times. Do you want to know why? It's because our God is a generous God. We worship a generous God. When we gather in here and we sing songs, we are worshiping and honoring a God who gave everything for us. Everything we have is His. And when we can recognize that and practice that, when we realize that every breath you take, every move you make, every bond, no, okay, sorry, I got a little distracted. Everything you have is His. And when we recognize that, it's life-changing because we see that we love and serve and worship a generous God. And generosity, really, if you want to define it, what it is, it's being an unselfish person. It's being a person who sees the needs of others and prioritizes them over your own needs. That when you see something going on in someone else's life, you see, how can I help to be a generous person with my time? Or how can my talents or my treasure help to add something to their happiness? That is what generosity is. And another thing that's important to understand is that you can be generous without being loving, but you cannot be loving without being generous. I can give and not really care about you at all, but if I claim to love you, if I tell you right now I love my wife and my daughters, and yet I don't meet their needs, I'm not a generous father, I'm not a generous husband, I don't give to them generously, you would probably be right to question whether or not I truly love them the way I say I do. In fact, we see that in Scripture, right? For God so loved the world that He gave, right? Generosity and love go together. They're important. If you love someone, you're going to be generous with them. And God has called us to love Him and love others. And that's a really important truth here. Another thing I think that's important to understand is a lot of times when we think about the word love, we get confused because a lot of songs that are on the radio, or I don't know if we listen to the radio anymore, on your Spotify or whatever, that claim to be love songs, they're really, I would consider them lust songs. Because love is about what you can do for someone else. Lust is about what they can do for you. And when we recognize that we are called to love people, right, we're called to see how can we do something for them and not to be constantly thinking about how they can be doing something for us. We're called to be a generous church. So, most of the time in church, when a pastor is doing a sermon on generosity, you're going to hear these words. Open your Bible to Malachi chapter 3. I don't want to spend a lot of time in Malachi chapter 3 today. It's a great passage. I do want to ask you to turn there, but only for a quick moment. I want to point out something that we've probably overlooked often as a church. So grab your Bible, turn with me to Malachi chapter 3. We're going to get to your notes here in a second. If you all of you have your pens ready to write a word into a blank, hold on. We'll get there in just a moment. Malachi chapter 3. Malachi is the last book of the Old Testament. So if you know where to find Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, just go backwards a little bit. Go ahead and grab a Bible from the seat back in front of you if you need one. If you don't own a Bible, write your name in this Bible and take it home with you. We want you to own a Bible. All right? So Malachi chapter 3, verse 10, and it says, "Bring all the tithes into the storehouse, so there will be enough food in my temple. If you do, says the Lord, If you do, says the Lord of heaven's armies, I will open the windows of heaven for you. Here's what we often overlook in this passage. What it's saying is that there's a floodgate, there are windows in heaven that are holding back all of sorts of blessings that could be poured out on you. Do you know what that means? God, listen, God doesn't need you or your talent or your treasure or your time to fulfill his purpose on this earth. He has heaven floodgates with all of the time and talent and treasure he needs to accomplish his purpose. He doesn't need you to give of your time, talent, and treasure to somehow fill up his storehouses. His storehouses are beyond capacity. I want us to recognize that. So if we are not giving for the purpose of God needing, what are the benefits of being a generous person? And I wrote down 10 for us to look at together. The first one is this. Number one, generosity honors God. If you're a note taker, we're doing something a little different this Sunday. I got some fill in the blanks for you to help you follow along. I'm going to be going through these points really quick. So that's why I put the scripture there for you and wrote out most of these. Generosity honors God. In other words, when you are generous, it's an act of worship. It's a way that you tell God, I trust you, and I believe that you are who you say you are. I believe that everything I have is yours, and I honor you by giving back to you. Proverbs 14:31 says, whoever oppresses a poor man insults his maker, but he who is generous to the needy honors his maker. In other words, when you are generous, you are honoring God. Number two, generosity helps transform me to be more like Jesus. Generosity helps transform us. Listen, the whole idea of the Christian journey, the whole idea of part of what your goal is while you're here, other than making Jesus famous and sharing the good news with others, in your own personal life, if you can be more like Jesus today than you were yesterday, that's being transformed into the likeness of Christ. That's a really good thing. Our goal every day should be to be more like Jesus than we were the day before. Tomorrow, I pray that you will be more like Jesus than you were today, that you are showing spiritual growth in your life and maturity. And if you want to be more mature in your faith, if you want to be transformed to be more like Jesus, then you are going to give like Jesus gave. And Jesus gave it all. He gave his life for me. He gave his life for you. Jesus was an incredibly generous, loving person. And when you give, you become like Christ. We see in Proverbs 21:26, it says, some people are always greedy for more, but the godly love to give. In other words, the Christ-like love to give. Would you like to be like Christ? Do you want to be Christ-like? Because if you do, according to Scripture, the godly, the Christ-like love to give. Do you love to give? That's an important step in being transformed into the likeness of Christ. I think of this example. If I were to drive through McDonald's in a hurry, you know, I got to get my whole family, my three daughters in the back seat, my wife in the passenger seat, and we got to get dinner on the run, right? So I go through McDonald's drive-thru, and I get some Happy Meals, and as I'm handing them back, just imagine, I'm a little hungrier than I thought, so I pop open one of those Happy Meals, and as I'm handing it back, I grab a fry out, and I eat it. Do you know what I'm probably going to hear from the back seat? Daddy, that was my fry. You know what ought to go through my mind in that moment? I am the provider of all fries, right? I drove us here. I worked to put money in the bank so that when I got to the first window, I could hand over my card and that transaction would be authorized. I'm the one who ordered it. I'm the one who pulled up to the second window and grabbed it. I'm the one who handed it back. I am the reason you have fries. Ought to be going through my head, okay? Here's another thing that probably ought to go through my head. At any moment, I have the authority to reclaim all fries. I can say, listen, hand those fries back up here. Those are mine now. I have that power. And here's another truth in this moment. If I want, I don't need their fries. I can pull through that drive-thru again, and I can order 10 more fries if I want to. I didn't need that fry. And here's the truth of understanding that all fries, listen, God is the source of all fries. Listen, and when we see someone kind of coming in and grabbing one of our fries and we have that attitude of, hey, that's my fry. We make that really, I mean, we laugh at it, right? In this illustration, it seems funny that my kids would think that they're their fries, but we think about our stuff like that all the time. We think about our money and our time and our talent. And listen, the fact is that Jesus doesn't need our fries. He doesn't often claim them back. He gives generously to us. And if we want to be like Christ, we will be generous too. You see, generosity helps to transform us to be more like Jesus. Number three, generosity draws me near to God. Generosity draws me near to God. Here's the idea. What you invest in is a good sign of what you are drawing near towards. Listen, if I'm just going to give you a good example. If I want to get a new car and I want to have the money in the bank when I go get that car, I am going to invest strategically. I'm going to set money aside so that I have money when I go get the car. In other words, I am drawing nearer each time I put money in that account to the day that I get to go to the car dealership and get a new car. I am drawing near to the things I invest my money in. And when we constantly look at our own lives and see what are we investing in, what are we putting our money into, what are we putting our time into, what are we putting our talents into, it is a really good sign of what you are drawing near to. What is most important in your life? If you want to draw near to God, you will invest your money in things that are important to Him, which we know to be His church and His people and Him. We will invest in things that are important to God. We see in Deuteronomy 14, 23, it says that, listen how clear this is. The purpose of tithing is to teach you to always put God first in your lives. If you ever wondered what tithing was about, there it is, as clear as day. Now, Matthew 6, 21 says, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Here's the hard truth. I could look at your bank book and probably figure out where your heart is. Someone could look at my account and know what's really important to me. If I spend a week in California, you'll know how important In-N-Out Burger is to me by looking at my bank book. You can find out where someone's heart is by looking at where they're investing their time and their talent and their treasure. Number four, generosity demonstrates my faith. In other words, it shows that you are trusting that God is who God says He is. Do you believe that God is the source of all good things? Do you believe that He's the source of blessing? Do you believe that He's the source of all fries? Because if you do, generosity is one thing that demonstrates that you have that trust. In 2 Corinthians 9:13, it says, for your generosity to them and to all believers will prove, underline that word, will prove that you are obedient to the good news of Christ. What does your pattern of generosity prove? If I looked at whether or not you are a generous person or you tend to be a more selfish person, is your faith being proved by your generosity? Philemon 1:6 says, I am praying that you will put into action the generosity that comes from your faith, and you understand and experience all the good things we have in Christ. Number five, generosity reveals my character. Generosity reveals my character? In other words, do I have a selfish heart or a generous heart? If I want to know whether or not I am a person of character, I can look at whether or not I'm a generous person, whether or not I care about other people, or I'm only concerned about myself. Because selfish people, if you look at any character flaw, what you're going to find out is at the root of that, it's you putting yourself first and putting other people second. You see, God uses his money to see if he can trust you with more. In Luke 6:16-11, it says this, "If you are untrustworthy about worldly wealth, who will trust you with the true riches of heaven?" Can God trust you? Are you a person of character? As God is pouring blessing into your life, can you be trusted with it? Are you a person of generosity? Number six, generosity cures materialism. You see, materialism is all about getting. It's all about you. It's me, 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 take, 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 right? That's what materialism is. And if I asked, I'm going to ask this question, and everyone should put their hand up, so don't be like shy to put your hand up. I'm going to put mine up. How many of us in this room struggle at times, sometimes more than we like, with being selfish, right? We do, right? We are selfish people. That our sin nature constantly rears its ugly head, and we find ourselves, some are keeping their hands up. Good for you. Man, that's awesome. All right, listen. Sometimes we find that we are selfish people, and it kind of rears its ugly head. If you want to know the cure for that, the antidote for your materialism is generosity. It sounds like it doesn't make quite sense. Like you're telling me to cure one thing, to just do the opposite. Yes, that's exactly what I'm saying. Start small if you have to. If you have to figure out a way, I'm just going to start being a more generous person, and you will watch how that materialism, that selfishness, starts to dwindle as you see all the benefits and the joy and the happiness that comes from being like Christ. Matthew 6:24 says, "You cannot serve both God and money. One is going to be more important to you." Materialism would be serving God, or serving money, and godliness would be serving God. You see, the two are opposites. They don't go together. 1 Timothy 6:17 and 18 says, "Command those who are rich." Let's pause right there. That's us, all right? If you're thinking right now, I'm not very wealthy. Listen, compared to the rest of the world, you are likely in the top 1% of wealth. We are a rich country. If you go to a store to get a new phone when the phone you already have works, guess what? You're wealthy, okay? We are wealthy people. Command those who are rich in this present world not to be arrogant, nor to put their hope in wealth, which is so uncertain, but to put their hope in God, who richly provides us with everything for, listen to this, for our enjoyment. How generous is our God? Not only does he provide for us, but he provides for us with a purpose, not just of meeting our needs, but so that we can also enjoy the blessings he's given to us. Command them to do good, to be rich, not just financially, but to be rich in good deeds, and to be generous and willing to share. Listen, church, if you are rich, this verse says, command those who are rich, command those who live in one of the wealthiest countries in the world to do good things with the blessings they have. That's my job right now. I was Paul talking to Timothy, and right now I'm telling you, do good things with the blessings you've been given. Be a generous person. Number seven, generosity brings God's blessing. Generosity brings God's blessing. It's really easy to misunderstand this verse and to take it too far. Some churches practice this thing called the prosperity gospel. It's an understanding of if you pour into the church and you give money to the church, then you're going to go out to the mailbox when you go home, and there's going to be a check that's twice that big, and the way God is going to pour blessing into you is going to be material, earthly blessing. And we don't necessarily believe that to be true. God can do that. God sometimes does bless you materially and in an earthly way. You'll see that as you give, that God provides somehow. But a lot of the times we misunderstand that, because if we look just at the New Testament, if we look at what happened to the men closest to Jesus who committed their lives to him, we see that they died a martyr's death at a young age as poor people. So please do not misunderstand this, that Matt is saying if you give and you're a generous person, that you are going to become rich. God's blessing works in so many different ways. God can bless you financially. God can bless you with health, with longer life. He can bless you eternally in heaven. He can bless you by meeting a need that you didn't think could be met. He can bless you in so many different ways, but we know that generosity brings God's blessing. Let me show you four verses. Proverbs 22:9 says the generous will themselves be blessed. Deuteronomy 15:10 says, give generously to the poor, not grudgingly, for the Lord your God will bless you in everything you do. 2 Corinthians 9 says, don't give reluctantly or in response to pressure. In other words, don't just give because Pastor Matt tells you you should. If you are only giving because you feel pressured or obligated to do so, this verse says don't do that. Don't give reluctantly or in response to pressure, for God loves a person who gives cheerfully. And God will generously, because he's a generous God, provide all you need. Get this, and then you will always have everything you need and plenty left over to share again. Psalm 112, 5 through 6, all goes well for the generous man who conducts his business fairly. Such a man will not be overthrown by evil circumstances. If you are an employee, maybe you own your own business, and you have learned how to conduct your business with generosity and with fairness and to treat people the way they're going to be treated, this verse does not promise that evil will not come. It just says that when things happen, you will not be overthrown by them. That's an incredible promise here in Scripture. Number 8, generosity makes a difference. Generosity makes a difference. In other words, the more generous you become, the more influential you will be, the more of a change maker you will make, you will become. A lot of times, I'm going to tell you right now, as a lead pastor of this church, I believe that right now in this room, at this very moment, there are people who will make an incredible, huge change, an incredible champion for Christ for the sake of the gospel. I believe there are people right now in this room that God is calling to be champions for the sake of the gospel. And what a lot of times we do is you hear that and you start looking to the right or the left and you're thinking, I wonder if it's them. How about we start praying, God, make that me. I want to be the one that Matt is talking about right now. I want to be the one who has incredible influence in changing the world for the sake of the gospel. If you want to be an influential person, the Bible says you have to also be a generous person. You have to be willing to give of yourself. Proverbs 11:24 puts it this way, the world of the generous gets larger and larger, but the world of the stingy gets smaller and smaller. Psalm 112 verse 9 says, they share freely and give generously to those in need. Their good deeds will be remembered forever. They will have influence and honor. Y'all, I want to be a church of influence. I want to be a church filled with believers, with Christ followers who are dedicated to making a difference for the sake of the gospel. And that means we have to be a generous church. My wife and I recognized the need for generosity early, in the very beginning of our marriage. Listen, the very first 6 months of our marriage, we had so little, and I did not want to ask her parents or my parents for help. I wanted the whole leave and cleave thing we took very seriously. We slept on the ground for the first 6 months of our marriage because we couldn't afford a mattress. We ate ramen. I remember going to the grocery store with $11 in the bank and a calculator, and everything that went in that shopping cart was calculated with tax, because we didn't want to be that couple that gets up to the counter and has to start putting things back. Like, we understood what it was, what it looked like to have bare cupboards, and even in that, we committed, we are going to be generous people. We are going to tithe a tenth of our income. We recognize that even in the moments of our lives where it seems really, really hard to be generous, even in those moments, it's almost more important to be a generous person. And what we recognize is that God was working and increasing our influence and the ways that we were able to make a difference in our community. And he was blessing us in that. And we started giving more. We said, hey, let's go up to 11%. And God kept working, and we kept proving that we can't outgive him. So we said, let's do 12. And we've made that decision quite a few times since then. And we keep upping how much we give because we recognize the blessing that comes from being a generous person. And I want to be a change maker. I want to be influential for the sake of the gospel. And I want you to be also. There's a pastor named Rick Warren who wrote the best-selling nonfiction book ever called The Purpose-Driven Life. So outside of the Bible, it's one of the best-selling books of all times. And somebody asked Rick Warren, why do you think God chose you to write this book? And Rick answered right away without even thinking about it. He said, I know why God chose me to write this book, because he knew he could trust me with the money. You see, Rick Warren, he's a pastor in California of a huge mega church. He drives a 15-year-old beat-up pickup truck. He tells people the watch he has is from Walmart. He lives in a modest home. He gives 91% of his income away. He knew that he was willing to be generous when the cupboards were bare, so God had been blessing him and providing him and trusting him with more wealth because he knew he would be willing to give it and to continue to further the purposes of the gospel. And there's people in this room right now, you're thinking, shoot, if I had $1 million, I'd be generous too. I hate to say this, but no, you wouldn't. If you're not willing to be generous when there's not a lot, what makes you think you're going to be generous when there's a bunch? If you're not willing to be generous when the cupboards are bare, you're not going to be generous later. Because you've already got in your mind that this world is about you. Number 9, generosity increases my happiness. Generosity increases happiness. The other day, my two oldest daughters were in a dance class, and my youngest daughter and my wife were at shopping, waiting for the girls to get out. They were at like the Dollar General picking up a few things we needed, and my youngest, my 5-year-old Molly, she saw something she wanted to get for her sisters. She saw something, I think Michaela and Madeline would really like this, so she bought it with her own money. And then that night when I got home and the girls got home, she had put together a scavenger hunt for her sisters to go through to get the gift that she had got them. And to see the joy in this 5-year-old that she got it. There's so much joy and happiness in generosity, isn't there? Like, listen, when you're young, at Christmas time, who is Christmas about? It's about getting, right? It's about you. When you wake up, you don't care about the gift that you got your parents or that mom got for you to give to dad, right? You don't care about that. You want to know what people got for you. But eventually, you become a dad. You become a mom. You grow up, and you see that the true joy at Christmas time is not from the opening of presents for you, but it's in the watching other people open things that you've gotten for them. That generosity is so full of happiness. And unfortunately, there are people who still think Christmas, even in adulthood, is still about them. And my advice to you is to grow up. It's not. Like, this world does not revolve around us. We were not placed here for everything to be about us. We were called to be transformed into the likeness of the most generous person we've ever encountered, and that's Christ. then generosity will increase your happiness. Acts 20, verse 35 said, the Lord Jesus himself said, there is more happiness in giving than in receiving. There you go. Number 10, generosity multiplies my money. Generosity multiplies my money. Here's the best way to explain this. I believe, because I've experienced it in my own life, I've watched this happen time and time again in my home, God can do more with 90% of my income than I can do with 100% of my income. In other words, when I entrust that first fruits to God, when my wife and I say, you know, we are going to give a tithe and then an additional offering to our church or to these other things that we're passionate about. You know, we have some compassion kids we sponsor and some things that make our heart kind of happy, right? There are things that where we're generous. When we look at what's left, it's amazing to us to watch God somehow multiply that, and that what's left was able to go farther than 100% would have gone by itself. I don't know how he does it. It's just these random blessings, these things that happen, this tax refund that you weren't expecting. How do you get more back than you put in? I still don't get it. But somehow God works and he uses things, and somehow God will make sure that 90% goes further than 100% would have under your own power. It's amazing to watch God multiply our money. Let me show you another a couple verses. Proverbs 11:25 says, the generous will prosper. Those who refresh others will themselves be refreshed. Do you need refreshing? 2 Corinthians 9:11 says, you will be enriched in every way so that, listen to that, so that you can always be generous. And I want to wrap up with this verse, 1 Timothy 6:18 and 19. It says, use your money to do good. Let's pause right there for a second. Will you do me a favor and circle the word use? Circle that word use, because that's a really, really important word. Money, you see, is not good or bad. Money is a complete neutral thing. Money is designed to be used, and people are designed to be loved. And what happens when somebody is not a generous person, but is instead a stingy or selfish person, you find the opposite to be true, that people are being used and money is being loved. And that's not the way these things were designed to work. Money is meant to be used. People are designed to be loved. Let's keep reading. It says, always being ready to share with others whatever God has given them. By doing this, they will be storing up real treasure for themselves in heaven. It is the only safe investment for eternity. And they will be living a fruitful Christian life down here as well. In other words, church, when you are a generous person, somehow in giving, God multiplies that gift. And not only is he going to make sure your needs are taken care of down here as well, you are storing up for yourself. You are multiplying and investing your money in eternity. So the question is, where do you want to be investing your time and your talent and resources? Do you want to benefit in the 80 years you have here, or in the trillions of years you're going to be able to enjoy it in the presence of God? Let's be a generous people who invest our money properly. You've never seen a hearse carrying a U-Haul. So don't live like that here. So what? So what now? With all these 10 things, what should we do? Here's my takeaway for you to consider. Is church, would you be a generous church? Are you willing to be generous with your time and your talent and your treasure? And there's a couple ways you can do that. You can start practicing that right away. One is through a thing called a tithe. It's a gift to the church. A tithe actually means a tenth. And I know for a lot of you, that's a huge chunk of change. But remember, God is the source of all fries, and I promise you, he will go further with whatever's left than you would have been able to go by yourself. The antidote for materialism is generosity. Become a generous person. How about with your time and your talents? Are you serving in the church? Are you using your time and your talent outside of the church to make a difference for the community? Are you helping and serving your family and your neighborhood? How are you using your time and your talent? Let's be a generous church together. I'm going to pray, and then I have a video I want y'all to, it's a lyric, it's a song that I want us to listen to and read while we take our offering this morning, and then we'll dismiss. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for the way you're so generous to us. I pray right now as we take an offering that you would help us to remember to be generous. God, not just today, but with all of our lives, help us to be generous with our time and our talent and our treasure. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.